at White Plains, we are disciple-making, disciples of Jesus who love God, the community, and each other. And I just want to say to our guests, thank you for being with us this morning. If you're new to us this morning, you are an answer to prayer. I'm so thankful that you have joined us in worship this morning. I also want to officially welcome Riley and Emily Davis. They were up here. We voted on them last week overwhelmingly. We said, we want you guys to lead us in worship, and we're so thankful they said yes, and they said, let's start next week, and here we are, and it's been a wonderful morning of worship already, so thank you so much for being with us this morning and being a part of our church family. Kids, it's always good seeing you. It seemed like I've seen some of y'all yesterday and maybe the day before, and we've had a fun week of Vacation Bible School, and I've got a video that I'd like to, for us to sort of just recap a little bit of what happened over the past few days. Would you play that video for us? So that was just under 2 minutes. It can't really show all that we did. I want to say thank you to those who volunteered and who were bringing their friends and family and for the kids that were here. Thank you so much for being a part of the last few days. It was a wonderful time. And I saw some amazing things in our church family. I saw some really cool things with our students. Some of the things that I saw relationships being formed and strengthened here this week through Vacation Bible School with our kids, with each other as adults, just a fun time. We were able to take Vacation Bible School on the road. So on Saturday, we were at Green Valley, and we were there a month ago and gave out some popsicles. We took the foam machine, good stuff is going to happen. I was wondering what folks were thinking as they were driving by and saw a big mess of foam in the yard over there. But I did feel a little bit bad because there was a couple of little bitty preschoolers that were coming out. They were going somewhere and they wanted to come. They would say no, but we had a really good experience with some of the families that were there. As we were leaving and packing up, one of the girls that was there, she opened her front door and said, thanks, come again. And I thought that was such a sweet thing. And I hope we can come again. I don't want this to be a one and done or a two and done over there. Some of our students were sitting there in the shelter. And one of the beautiful things that I heard was they were looking for ways to serve that neighborhood. They were sitting there, and that there was some graffiti on the ceiling of the shelter, and maybe we could repaint that for them. That was their thoughts. They also were thinking other simple things, just like sanding and refinishing the picnic table. They were kind of rough, and they were kind of abused, and just ways to, again, show love to our community. maybe there's a future there. So be praying for that. Be praying if there's ways that you sense that God could use our church and each other to show love to that wonderful, friendly community over there. Again, it was a really fun time. And you saw there at the end, you saw one of our church kids really just caring for one of the neighborhood kids there and spending time with her. And so it was just a beautiful thing seeing our church go on the road there and share the gospel and share love for the community. So kids, thanks so much for being part of Vacation Bible School. And we'll go ahead and dismiss you up to a kids' church. Kids' church is for kids in kindergarten through fifth grade. To go up to kids' church, our moment of prayer. This is a quiet moment, some things for us to consider as we pray, but pray as you want to this morning for sure in regards to what has happened yesterday and just the fallout from that, the future. We seem to be on shaky ground always, and that's probably true, but we do have a strong God who is in control of all things. So be in prayer for whatever is on your heart this morning, but some things that you could be praying for as we continue to pray for Mackenzie. One of her prayer requests is that she is learning Swahili. I guess that's what they speak over in Kenya. I don't know, but she is learning Swahili and wants to do better, be able to communicate in that native language over there. But be praying for her language studies there. Pray for someone sitting near you, and then just pray that God's word would speak to you this morning. Let's take just a moment of quiet prayer. I'll close us here about after a minute of prayer, but let's pray. God, we come to you weak. We come to you unable, and we come to you in need of you. Well, there are many things to be praying over and about, and Lord, we trust in your sovereignty. As we pray, we exercise trust in your sovereignty. We know that we can't do many things. We know that you can. And we trust that you are at work. You are not unaware of our needs. God, we thank you for being aware of us and for your love for us and your care and concern over us. Be with us this morning. Would your word speak to us in a way that we can understand, a way that we can apply and we can grow in. We thank you for Jesus. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So this morning we're going to be in Psalm 130. Summer is quickly passing us by. So we are moving toward the end of our Summer in the Psalms series. We've been over the Psalms of Ascent. And these, as a way of reminder, are psalms that people would pray on their way to worship. On their way to Jerusalem, they would pray these psalms. They would sing these psalms. These would be on their mind. They would go to worship. And as a way of application, I wanted us, I want to understand that our attitude on the way to church often affects our experience in church. And these psalms help us to prepare ourselves for worship as we think about who God is and what he has done and what he is doing. We've also discovered throughout this series that a four-letter word that's all capitalized. It's the word Lord. It's Yahweh. And it is God's personal name that he gave to himself, that he revealed to Moses. And so this is a very personal thing that we do as we worship God. We do it collectively for sure, but it's also very personal. In Psalm 130, you're going to notice, though, that there's a little bit of a difference. You still have that four-letter, all-capitalized word, but then you also have the other, another way of spelling the word as a capital L with lowercase O-R-D. And this is the word Adonai, and it means master. And so as you read through the psalm this morning, as you hear the words, you're going to hear Lord two different ways. It's two different words. We say Lord for both, but they're two different words, two different meanings. And as we go through it, I'll try to remember to say either Yahweh or Adonai. Okay? And we're going to see there's meaning behind this. It's not just for fun. The psalmist is saying something when he says Lord as Adonai. And as he says, Yahweh is five times in this psalm, and Adonai is mentioned three times. Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I will wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Let's pray in response to Psalm 130. God, we thank you for your word to us this morning. Hear us as we cry out to you this morning. Let your ears be attentive to our pleas for mercy. You are so good to us. Remind us of your goodness. Remind us of your faithfulness. Thank you for the forgiveness that you have given us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this morning, we're going to be looking at a big question. We're going to answer a big question here with Psalm 130. And there in your notes, if you want to put down the fill in the blank there, we're going to ask, what does it mean to be forgiven? What does it mean to be forgiven? Have you considered that question? What does it mean to be forgiven? Psalm 130 this morning will bring our attention to the past, the present, and the future of our forgiveness. As you consider your personal relationship with God, was there a time that you initially came to him? You have forgiveness and cleansed you of sin, but you then now live in a period where you continue to sin. So you need to keep forgiveness. Not that he won't do it, but keep coming to him knowing that he is the one forgiving you. And then we hope in a future forgiveness. We hope that there is, according to the Bible, and this hope is a trusting hope, a future completion of our forgiveness. There is real tension in our lives as we think about sin and salvation and sanctification. And these are all words that we'll explore this morning. But I want to introduce a phrase to you that you might not have heard that really does help us understand this tension that we live in. The phrase is already and not yet. When you hear this phrase, many times we think of the kingdom of God. It is already started. It's already happened. What the Bible says about the kingdom of God is true, and it's still coming. It's not yet. We live in this tension of already and not yet. Christ came. He directed it. And the kingdom of God. And this can drill down to our own personal experience of salvation. At one time in the past, we were saved. We are continuing to be saved. And one day we will completely be finally saved. It's already and not yet. Helps us understand this tension of what it means or what it's like to still sin after salvation. Because we do that, right? We still sin after our salvation. It happens to all of us. And so it can help us, it can bother us. Especially if we're new in our faith and we still struggle with sin, we need to understand that there is process, that God is doing something in us. We have been saved, we are being saved, and we will one day completely and fully be saved. Let's look at verses 1 and 2, and here I'm going to try to mention Yahweh and Adonai as we go through this. My voice, ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. Here the psalmist is really coming to grips with his personal sin. You see that? Do you see him coming to grips with his personal sin? He is pleading for mercy. We get a picture of him being underwater, in the depths, maybe even underground. That's where sin puts us. Sin kills us. It leads us to death. And he's crying out to Yahweh. He's saying, Master, hear my voice. The first step in forgiveness is to experience the misery of personal sin. The first step to forgiveness is to experience the misery of personal sin. How awful is your sin? It's probably not as bad as someone else's, if we're honest, but it's bad. It's awful. Our sin is awful. Your sin is awful. My sin is awful. We need to understand that sin, especially ours, is awful. If you don't think much of your sin, you won't think much of Jesus. Because you won't think you need much of Jesus. But when you think a lot and awfully a lot about your sin, you realize your great need. You will cry out from the depths to Yahweh. You'll say, Master, hear my voice. Sin is awful. There in your notes, the truth is we are dead and we are dying in our sin. Now I could preach about how good heaven will be. It will be good. Heaven will be wonderful. One day we will enjoy that. And I could preach that. And maybe one day I will, but this morning Psalm 130 doesn't teach that. Psalm 130 is teaching us about our sin. That we're dead and dying in our sin. Romans 6:23. First said, I hope you're I read it to you. Romans 6:23 says, For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord, our Master. Genesis 3:17-19 says this, And to Adam he said, God, Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and you've eaten of the tree of which I've commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles shall be. And you return. Sin deserves death. What started here in Genesis applies to each one of us, you, because we inherit our sin nature. We are all sinful because of what happens in Genesis 3. We should be in misery because of our sin. Misery leads to repentance. Misery. An honest view of our sin should put us in misery, and that misery should lead us to repentance. Pastors and churches should preach the reality of our sin. This is what we need to know. This is essential information for every one of us. We need to know the truth about ourselves. Let's continue in verses 3 and 4. If you, O Lord, Yahweh, should mark iniquities, O Master, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I've expressed this truth to you in the past. I've destroyed or ruined some clothing a couple of weeks ago trying to express this truth. Our sin is against a holy and perfect God. Bleach does a lot of damage to clothing, and that's what happened to me a couple of weeks ago when I was trying to express this truth, that our sin, although we may sin against others, ultimately is against a perfect and holy God. And God only deals one way with sin. Do you remember what I said? How God deals with sin? It's only one way. As humans, we experience two different expressions of this, but in reality, God only deals in one way with sin, and He punishes sin. That's what He does. That's what He ought to do, because our can experience forgiveness when we trust in Jesus, like Romans 6:23, but that sin that we have is based upon Jesus. Jesus really suffered for sin. Jesus really suffered for my sin. It wasn't just something that we read about. It was something that really happened because God punishes sin. Those who follow Jesus, that sin, we don't experience that punishment because we experience forgiveness. But that punishment, He suffered for you. And so the next step in forgiveness is to confess your personal sin. Facing our sin may lead to greater misery. Fully understand. It may lead us to understand how miserable we are. But don't stay in that misery. Verse 3, if you, O Lord, Yahweh, should mark iniquities, O Master, who could stand? When we really understand our sin, it might paralyze us. It might cause us deep regret and remorse and sadness. It should, as we understand the awfulness of our sin. But confession leads to forgiveness. And so for the Christian, we don't need to stay in that misery. Because, verse 4, but with you there is forgiveness. With the Lord there is forgiveness. We make the personal God, Yahweh, we make Yahweh our master, we experience forgiveness in Jesus, in Christ. In Christ, you are forgiven. The weight of your sin is not yours to carry alone. Jesus takes it on. He carries it for you, and you experience forgiveness, not punishment. Christ experiences the punishment. Let's look at verses 5 and 6. I wait for the Lord Yahweh. My soul waits, and in His word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord Adonai, for Master, more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. Now, while we wait for the Lord, we might experience the opposite of forgiveness. Because as we wait for the Lord, we're being set aside, we're being made new. And as we're being new, we will often mess up. We will often sin because that's still our nature. We are sinful creatures. And this is where this phrase, already and not yet, can come in and help us as we wait. We are already saved, those who trust in Jesus, and we're not yet completely saved. We're living in this messy middle of sanctification. And so we wait. Being hard is difficult. We can't stay in that misery, though, as we consider the sanctification process, as we mess up and are forgiven, and there's cycles. We hope through this waiting. We exercise hope. But what do we hope in? Hope is found in God's Word above all else. There in your notes, hope is found in God's Word above all else. I enjoy being your pastor. I love this church. I love you. And I am going to say something that might be hard for some to hear. It's not because I'm mad. It's because I love you. It's because I love this church. And I want us to understand the truth that Psalm 130 is telling us. And here's what it is. God's word is bigger than our feelings. God's word is better than our experiences. And God's word is more beautiful than our testimony. Now, that is not to say that our feelings, our experiences, and our testimony are bad, wrong, or not important. That's not what I said. What I did say is that God's word is bigger than our feelings. It is better than our experience. And it is more beautiful than our testimony. God's word is bigger, better, and more beautiful. And so when you experience misery over your sin, as you should when it comes to fruition, turn to the Bible. Turn to God's word quickly. Put an app on your phone. Memorize scripture so that it can come to you quickly and you can easily recall it. Turn to God's word as you lose the battle of temptation. Turn to God's word as you realize the sin that is in your life. As you do that, you are waiting well. As you do that, you are continually trusting God for your salvation. There in your notes, wait for the Lord in your salvation. Wait for the Lord in your salvation. When you stumble, when you struggle, wait and trust in the Lord. Go to His Word. Preach the gospel to yourself. Retell the gospel to yourself. You need to hear it over and over and over again. God's Word is bigger, better, and more beautiful. Let's continue in verses 7 and 8. O Israel, hope in the Lord Yahweh. For with the Lord Yahweh there is steadfast love, and with Him is plentiful redemption. And He will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. So Psalm 130 here brings up an interesting statement, an idea that I think many of us are confused by. And the question is, who is Israel? And I could probably speak at length on this. But here in Psalm 130, O Israel, hope in the Lord. And then in verse 8, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. So who is Israel? The Bible gives us four different categories of Israel. When you read the word Israel in your Bible, you may be reading about one of four or more than that, but there's four different types of Israel that the Bible authors are writing. The first is the ethnic group of all of Israel. That pretty simple. Anybody who is Jewish would be considered Israel. That's one way the Bible speaks of Israel when she speaks of Israel. The second is that ethnic group of Jews, but those who trust in the Lord. Romans 9:6 says this, for not all who are descended from Israel belong to Israel. So sometimes the Bible is speaking about a segment of Israel as being Israel. And these are the faithful ones who trust in the Lord, the ethnic Jews who trust in the Lord. The third group is the ethnic Jews who have not placed their faith in the Lord. So on one hand, it's those who do trust in the Lord. On the other hand, it's those who don't. So it can be very confusing. Romans 9:31 and 32 says, but that Israel who pursued a law that would lead to a righteousness did not succeed in reaching that law because they did not pursue it by faith, but as if it were stumbled over. You've heard the phrase, the gospel is a rock of offense and a stumbling stone. And so sometimes when the Bible is speaking of Israel, they're speaking of Israel, the ones who are stumbling over the stumbling stone, those ethnic Jews who've not placed their faith in Jesus. Then the fourth way that the Bible speaks of Israel is all of those who believe in Jesus, the church, all those who believe in the Lord. So the church, this is us. And so sometimes when the Bible speaks of Israel, it's really speaking of us. The psalmist here is looking at the second group, ethnic Jews who trust in the Lord. We can read Psalm 130 and insert ourselves as the church in this as you read. So, O church, hope in the Lord. For the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem the church from all his iniquities. That's how you can read that. And so the point here is we trust in the Lord. When you're trusting, you're exercising patience. And patience is also known as long-suffering. And that's a good way to describe patience, is long-suffering. Trusting and long-suffering go hand in hand. You did not accomplish your forgiveness. You received it by grace through faith. Trust in Jesus by grace through faith that he will keep you. He will. Waiting is active trust. Our salvation was completed by Jesus, is being completed by Jesus, and will one day be completely completed by Jesus. In this already and not yet, we must continue in our trust in Jesus. Live not yet. But this waiting isn't just a passive thingness. We have plenty to do in response to God's saving work in our life. Much of it has to do with prayer. Much of it has to do with activity. And says this, said this, sin or sin will be killing you. Think about that phrase as the worship team comes back up. Be killing sin or sin will be killing you. We're going to sing a final song here in just a moment. And this will be a new song for us. But I want you to pay attention to the words as we're going to be in a moment of prayer. The words come out of Psalm 130. the Psalms are meant to be sung, and Psalm 130 is a beautiful song to sing, and this song we're about to sing, you'll recognize these words because we just read them. You just heard a sermon about them. And I think a good way to respond to this passage in the Psalms is to sing it back to God. And so we're going to sing Psalm 130. Consider the lyrics as you pray. Have you been letting sin kill you? Or are you attempting to kill sin? Confess to God what needs to be confessed. The altar is open. You can come down and pray. You can pray right where you are. I will be down front. If you want to speak with me, you're able to do that. But would you stand as we pray this morning? God, we thank you for your word to us. We thank you for your powerful grace that saves us, that keeps us saved, and keeps us saved. Help us to trust and wait for you and on you. Lord, give us an understanding of our sin, even post-salvation. Give us the ability to kill sin in our lives for your sake. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.